sahanavavatu, sahanabhunaktu, sahaviryam karavavahai, tejasvinavadhitamastu mavidvishavahai. Om shanti shanti shanti. So the first verse in the Shatashloki has to do with Guru Stuti, praise of the teacher. The second verse is the praise of the parampara, the teaching tradition. The third verse is what we finished yesterday is what is called Mahapratigya. Mahapratigya means it's a thesis statement on what are the main things that are going to be touched on in the whole text. So it introduces the subject matter, and it introduces the subject matter in a very multi-layered way. It talks about the two portions of the Veda, and it talks about the Satyam and Mithya, the bread and butter of Vedanta, and it talks about, you know, so many topics, Atma, Anatma, and all these things it talks about. It doesn't leave anything in terms of a list, you know. It doesn't leave anything, you know. The list is very comprehensive and unique, and so it doesn't leave any kind of anything to be what's the word for it, to want. Then it also talks of Brahma, how Brahman is understood. First, it is understood from the standpoint of one's own self, Tvam Pada Vichara, and then Tat Pada Vichara. All these things are discussed. And then, what else is left? What is left is to talk about all these issues in detail. Because first you have touched on the topic, and then you have introduced lots of topics in very, very, you know, what is that, you know, great breadth. And now what is left is to go deeply into each one. So that is verse number 3. And then verses number 4 and 5, and partly 6 also, they talk about, they start with a very interesting and important issue in Vedanta. If I am Brahman, you know, then when did I become this Jiva? If I am all-pervasive, wonderful consciousness, then how come, you know, I'm trapped in this body? And if everybody knows that they are Brahman, you know, at least they read about it, and then what happens? And then they suddenly find themselves confusing themselves with the body. And if the Vedanta is so easy, then how come all the masses are, you know, out there not studying about this? These are all the questions that happen, and these are very important questions. If I am Brahman, then why, what am I doing in this body? Why am I here? Why am I confused with this? And this, you know, this thing called Dehatma Buddhi, and body is as good as I, mind is as good as I, senses are as good as I, then what? Possessions are as good as I, doership is as good as I, and then what else is there? You know, experiencership is as good as I, karta aham, bhokta aham, all these things have to be looked at. And then that is what the author is going to do, starting with verse number 3. Verse number four. So we will chant that and look at the various nuances here. Atma chidvit,
Atma chidvit,
Sukhatma,
Sukhatma,
Anubhava parichitah,
Anubhava parichitah,
Sarvadehadiyanta,
Sarvadehadiyanta,
Atma chidvid sukhatma,
Atma chidvid bhava parichitah
sarva deha adiyanta
sarva deha adiyanta
satyevam mudha buddhir bhajati
satyevam mudha buddhir bhajati
nanu janah
nanu janah
nitya dehatma buddhim
nitya dehatma buddhim
nitya dehatma buddhim
nitya dehatma buddhim
satyevam mudha buddhir bhajati nanu janah
satyevam mudha buddhir bhajati nanu janah
nitya dehatma buddhim
nitya dehatma buddhim
bahyo sthisnayu majja
palarudhiravasa
charma medo yugantah
charma medo yugantah
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 yeah because it is in sandhi with the first word in the last line so I am breaking it for you charma medo yugantah
charma medo yugantah
bahyo sthisnayu majja
bahyo sthisnayu majja
palarudhiravasa charma medo yugantah
charma medo yugantah
vinmutrashleshma purnam
vinmutrashleshma purnam
vinmutrashleshma purnam
vinmutrashleshma purnam
svaparava puraho
svaparava puraho
samveditvapi bhuyah
samveditvapi bhuyah
vinmutrashleshma purnam svaparava puraho
vinmutrashleshma purnam svaparava puraho
svaparava puraho
svaparava puraho
samviditvapi bhuyah
samviditvapi bhuyah
yeah, so together now atma chidvit sukhatma anubhava parichitah sarvadehadiyanta satyevam mudha buddhir bhajati nanu janah nitya dehatma buddhim bahyo sthisnayu majja palarudhiravasa charma medo yugantah vinmutrashleshma purnam svaparava puraho samviditvapi bhuyah there will be a prize for the proper chant all this you know see the third line and the fourth line are one sentence the whole of the third line is one word yeah so that's why it is difficult you have to keep breaking it yeah so atma let us just see the meaning first atma chid vid this is a very nice way of saying sachidananda so chid you know Chit is what? Chit. Everybody knows Chit. Chit is all knowledge, sentience, you know. And so Atma is Chit. And here, since it is self-effulgent and it knows it is Chit, so it is, you know, Chit Vetiti Chidvit. Chit Vit Chidvit. You know, very nice. So Atma Chidvit. So So what is this Atma? I is all knowing, and it knows itself and it knows everything else. Everything comes to becomes evident to it, and it is self-evident. That is what Chidvit means. And then it is Sukhatma. It is all Sukha. There is not even a lesha, a residue of sorrow in the Atma, in the I. Now, that Sukha is Ananda, Chidvit is Satchit together. So here Chidvit Sukhatma means Satchidananda Atma. It is existent, it exists, and then what does it do? It, it is all-knowing, it is existent, it knows itself, and it's the only source of knowledge. Everything becomes evident to it. It doesn't need to be objectified, it is self-evident, and then, it is limitless. That's why Ananda, Ananta, it is limitless. It doesn't have any limits of time, space, or object. There are threefold limitations discussed in the Shastra. What are they? Time-wise limitation,
space-wise
limitation, and object-wise. Deshataha, kalataha, vastutaha, parichinnatvam. If you want to impress friends, you can say it like that. So, time-wise limitation means like everything that is there, in the world is got some expiry date, After the expiry date, you cannot enjoy it, and it is finite. And then space-wise, every object occupies a certain volume, a certain mass, in a certain given space, weight, mass, volume, and it cannot be bigger than that, it cannot be other than that, So space-wise means it is also, space-wise mostly means it is in one place and it cannot be in another place, So if it is in one place, it will only be in that one place. It cannot be suddenly, at the same time appearing in two places at once. It's not possible. That is space-wise limitation. Object-wise, if it is a mango, it will not become an orange. It is mango. It is confined to being a mango. So like this, everything has these threefold limitations, and that which doesn't have limitations is what? I. No space-wise limitation. Why? It does not occupy space. Space has come from Atma. Atma has not, as Atma is not in space. Very simple, which you can understand. Space and time are and as though projections of Atma, not the other way around. Time again is relative. This the sages of the Upanishad and the Vedas in general knew that. Time is a construct, space is a construct, and so you cannot say, Atma is running out of time. Yeah. So, time is what is, time is an as though product of Atma, not the other way around. And then you can't have, space, time, and then object-wise limitations. Atma is only weighing 45 kilos. You cannot say that. Why? Because it is weightless, timeless, spaceless. So, and then you cannot say Atma is right now, in Hyderabad, in India, and it cannot be in Eugene, in America at the same time. That also doesn't make sense. And so therefore, that is why it is Chidvit. So that anything that is free of these three limitations naturally is a source of delight. That is because that is what one craves. One craves to be free of time and space. That's why everybody thinks in the beginning it's good to work from home because nobody is the boss. But then you ask the people working from home, they work even harder. And that, at least in the office, you leave everything at 5 o'clock and then come home. People who work from home, there is no 5 o'clock. And there is no, what is that, There is no separation between work and home. And then what happens? It just flows over, and at 12 o'clock, they are still working from home. And so, midnight. And so like this, Everybody doesn't want a boss. Nobody has to be the boss. You know, space, time-wise, I want to be free. And then what? Space-wise, also I want to be free. That's why, and the freedom from, you know, spatial limitations is expressed in dangerous sports, like skydiving. I want to conquer this. Mountain climbing, going to Everest. Phir udhar jaake, going there, standing in a queue. This is what happened last year. Overcrowding. Because everybody has the same idea of how to conquer space, conquer time. And they don't see that it's more of a, as though in the conquest, and they think it is outer conquest. So then space-wise limitation, nobody wants. That's why everybody wants a bigger house, a bigger this, a bigger that, bigger deck, and everything big, 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 big. And then what, you know? And then dream house. And then two bedrooms for each grandchild, they build. And then after that, what? The so-called grandchild never comes. Maybe one day in a year it will come. And the rest of the time, you know, the elderly grandparents are rolling around in this huge house. And then they try to sell it. Nobody wants to buy your dream house. Your dream house is their nightmare. They want their own dream house. Very difficult to sell also. So this is the way the spatial limitations are, you know, shown. Temporal limitations, spatial limitations, object-wise also. People want to be everything all at once, all-knowing. That's why things like Harry Potter, you know, and its Punjabi counterpart, Harry Potter, you know, are doing so well. Yeah. So, there are comic books, Harry Potter, and Harry Potter is exactly like Harry Potter. So like they are doing very well, because here, you know, what is that, flying through space, invisible cloaks, and all these things, because you are not an object-wise, you are not limited by the body, you can do all kinds of feats, and so such, you know, movies, books, etc., become very, very, very popular. Yeah, I'm not making this up. Some things I do make up, but this is not one of them. You can Google it, not right now, okay? Yeah, but later on you can Google and see. Read some episodes online. And so, that is, you know, this is all there, but the Atma, that one is striving here to be all these things. But the I is naturally free of time, space and object-wise limitations. This is what is indicated in the first line, first word, Atma, Chidvid Sukhatma. And then it is known, how do you know this? Anubhava Parichitaha. Parichitaha means, it is Chitaha, collected. Parichitaha, collected over a period of time, thoroughly collected. And then, what is thoroughly collected? Collected through anubhava. One knows this by one's own experience. You don't have to go and ask the neighbor, hello, do I exist? Is my nature to be happy or sad? Please tell me. You don't have to ask somebody. Everybody knows I'm supposed to be happy. I told you, even the pharmaceutical companies know that happiness is the nature of the Atma. That's why there are so many over-the-counter antidepressants, anti-anxiety, because anxiety is not you, they will tell. Depression is not you. They all know, everybody knows. So how do they know? Anubhava parichitaha, chit from ching chayane, you know, to collect. And parichitaha, nicely collected, you know. So everybody has done some kind of a research on themselves, because what they, you know, in sleep they feel wonderful and they hate to wake up, you know. Monday morning is a syndrome by itself, and then, you know, and they don't like to wake up. So this is all information for research. Lifelong research is conducted on this particular topic. Because, you know, I love to sleep, you know, I hate to wake up. In sleep, there is no problems, no space-wise limitations, no time-wise limitation, no object-wise limitation. Nobody bothers me. I'm not a bother to myself, you know. Sleep is like moksha. Whether one gets moksha in sleep or not, other people get moksha from you. So please sleep, okay? Yeah, so, you know, you give a respite to other people. And unless, of course, you're having sound sleep. Yeah, what is sound sleep?
Full of sound.
Yeah, sleep that makes a sound. This was used to be Pujya Swamiji's famous joke. So in sleep, there is no problems. When I wake up only, all the problems start. Even when I'm awake, if I'm watching something funny or if I'm doing something, you know, where I'm able to get out of this, you know, routinized thinking that I'm subject to sorrow, then also I seem to be fine. And so what is the problem over here? And where is this happiness? Why is it so elusive? This kind of a research, one knows. And one knows one should be happy and one is not. And that's why there is a striving for this happiness. That also one knows. So all this is what? That I am Satchidananda is Anubhava Siddhaha. Parichitaha means collected through observation and experience. Meaning what? Anubhava Siddhaha. I know that I am Satchidatma, Satchidananda Atma. I know that I am supposed to be happy. My nature is to be happy. And that's why I reject even the slightest episode of anger, sadness, fear is completely rejected and kept at bay. And so what? Therefore what? Sarva Dehadi Yanta. You know, Sarva Dehadi Yanta means this also is known, you know. This is not fully known, but somehow one gets the idea that this Atma is the Yanta, Niyanta, you know, Yamayati. Yamayati means the disciplining agent, or how to translate that, the one that oversees or indwells and is in charge of all bodies. Somehow that vague understanding of oneness is also there, because one is constantly wanting to be one with something or the other, and wanting to be one with something, you know, produces a longing for, you know, uniting with the finite. You know, you want to be one with the house, you want to be one with the spouse, you want to be one with the child, and you know, and the this is what it is, and all of those things are finite, but still that pull to be one with everything is very, 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 very strong. So therefore, Sarva Dehadi Yanta, it is the truth of all bodies, it is the overseer of all bodies, the indweller of all bodies. And then what, you know, Sati Evam, if this being the case, Evam Sati, this being the case, Moodha Buddhihi Bhajati. You know, Bhaja Sevayam. Bhaja doesn't mean worship, you know, all the time. You know, Sevayam. Sevayam Sevate. Sevayam means the person is in service of. Bhajati means the person serves. Who is this person? Moodha Buddhihi. Moodha Buddhi means what? Yeah, the person of deluded buddhi, the person serves or goes after or nourishes, nurtures. Mooda buddhihi bhajati nano janaha. So who is this mooda buddhihi? All the janas, all the people. Jana means people. So you don't have to take it personally. You know, one thing about Ajnanam, you can say, thank God I'm not alone. Otherwise you would feel so shy and ashamed, you know. And in this culture, there's a lot of shaming. You know, if somebody has got the wrong hair color, it is shaming. And then if somebody has, you know, a different weight, body shaming, mind shaming, all these things. So then in addition to that, supposing everybody was a jnani and you alone were a jnani, then there would be ajnani shaming. So you would not be able to go out also, you know. Ayo, I have dehatma buddhi. Ayo, I how to go, how to face all these people. Ayo, should I go out? You know, you'll be looking like this. So thank God, everyone is an Ajnani, you know. Jnanis are few and far between, and so therefore, there is some solace, you know, because you are in good company. So Modha Buddhir Bhajat, Modha Buddhihi Bhajati Sevate. So the one of deluded Buddhi is always going after, is always preoccupied with what Dehatma Buddhim Bhajati. That is at the end of the second line. Kim Bhajati? Dehatma Buddhim Bhajati. So the person, Bhajati means Sevate. The person completely nourishes, nurtures, and puts water and miracle grow on the notion, I am this body. Keeps on growing this notion as the person also grows. So the first the person grows this notion, and then the person, after growing this notion, sits and groans. Why me? This is what the whole thing is. So Modha Buddhihi Dehatma Buddhim Bhajati. So Modha Buddhihi, so the ignorant person mistakes the body for the I. Deha eva atma iti buddhi dehatma buddhihi tam dehatma buddhim bhajati. And then what, you know, and then nanu janaha. Nanu janaha means what? Not just one person, indeed everyone comes into this category. Janaha, people at large, what do they do? Nitya dehatma buddhim bhajati. All the time they just completely worship, go after, nurture this I notion, you know, and associate it with the body, and think, come to the wrong conclusion, even after, you know, even after Atma is, what is that, you know, self, even though Atma is self-evident, they come to the wrong conclusion. And what is the wrong conclusion? I am as good as the body, you know, they come to this wrong, horrid conclusion. And then what, you know, how do they come to this conclusion? You know, they come to this conclusion because they see the outside, the external body, bahya, and they objectify it. And what is bahya? What is external? First we start with the bones, asthi, bones, snayu, connective tissue, majja. Majja is some kind of a bone marrow. Pala, flesh, muscles, etc. Then rudhira, blood. Vasa, tendons, or you know, arteries also are vasa. And then charma, skin. Medha, fat. So this is an assemblage. And you know, yugantaha means an assemblage. So they see the body, which is an external assemblage of bones, marrow, fat, skin, arteries, and all these things, blood, flesh, you know, tendons, connective tissue, etc. So they mistake this, and why is he, you know, talking about each and every one of them in particular? Because he wants us to see that they have nothing to do with the Atma. Flesh is flesh, bones are bones, and each one is an object of my sight, and it has nothing to do with the Atma, he wants us to see. And that's why he's naming each one. And when you name each one, then the power of that to internalize that goes away, you know. In the meditation also we do this, keeping the external world external, like that. So this is what the whole thing is. So Atma Chidvit Sukhatma Anubhava Parichitaha Sarvadehadiyanta. So even though Atma is all pervasive, all knowing, limitless, of the nature of total, you know, what is that, delight as a result of that, and it is unchanging Atma, and it is the same in all bodies, it pervades all bodies, even though sati evam, even though then the foolish or the deluded person keeps on growing the I notion. Not only in their body, but in all bodies, they keep growing the I notion as associated with all the finite bodies, etc. And then, as though this was not enough, this assemblage, he has more to say. Wind means, excrement. Mutra, urine. Shleshma, shleshma means phlegm, All the waste products of the body are talked about. So all the waste products of the body, meaning the body is just filled with. So outside, what do you see? Bones, marrow, flesh, all these things. This is like a science lesson in the third line. And then inside, the body is just filled with, manure, dung, urine, all these things. And this is a disgusting assemblage. And this is to give you vairagya. When you read this, you feel like not having dehatma buddhi at all. So in addition to talking about why it is difficult for the people to see that one is the atma, verse number 4 has the additional intent and the prasada of driving you crazy and then seeing once and for all exorcising this dehatma buddhi from within the body, So that's why even Atma Bodha is like that. Atma Bodha also says that whatever thing you love, you think of the thing you love, and then some nice chocolate cake comes to mind or some nice ice cream comes to mind. And then he says, in order to get vairagya, convert it into kakavishta, crow dropping. Yeah. In place of that, see crow dropping. Or see crow dropping on top of that, many of them. And then will you want to eat that? Will you then want to eat that? Obviously not, you say, disgusting. This is how in modern prisons, they have taken this. This is called aversion therapy for repeat offenders. And where there is a lot of recidivism, they go out of the prison and they do the same thing. Sex offenders, etc. So then what they might do is they'll show a beautiful woman dancing. And then all of them in group therapy, let's go, how nice. And then immediately they show sewage after that, And the images are immediately juxtaposed so that, the person is shocked. All the sense organs are shocked. The ahankara is shocked into, getting vairagya from that particular, whatever that image was, over which they have no control in responding. So here also, dehatma buddhi is an addictive behavior. It's a behavior based on ajnana, and it is a behavior based on anyatha jnana. Ajnana is okay, no problem. I don't know myself, but the problem is I take myself to be the body. This is what it is. And this body notion is addictive. It feeds me, I feed it, literally and figuratively. I keep growing the I notion. The body also keeps growing, and then what? Then after that, reaching adulthood also, it's the same thing. And then the dehatma buddhi doesn't go unless one, submits oneself to Vedanta instruction. And then meanwhile, what is happening? One is, stewing in the dehatma buddhi because it's a deluded, buddhi to think I'm the body. And one is coming to grave suffering because of that. And what kind of pain does dehatma buddhi give? Dehe nashte, aham nashtaha. So karma, body is a product of prarabdha karma. And so prarabdha karma means things will start unfolding. And it is also set to unfold with age, With age, so many things happen, where to start, Suddenly something aches. Suddenly, and then you say, till yesterday it wasn't paining, suddenly it is paining. Well, it had to start someday. Like this lady came to me. You know, she said, up till now, I'm very, first she looked very worried. I said, what happened? I'm very anxious. I said, what happened? Why? I just came back from the doctor. I said, is everything okay? Yeah, but I have hypertension. And then I said, how do you know? The doctor took the BP and put me on a pill. I said, well, that's good. At least it was caught and, you know, now you can, you know, rest. You can take the pill and you'll be all right. At least it'll be managed. And then she says, but what I don't understand, it wasn't there yesterday. How it came today? I said, did you check your BP yesterday? She says, no. I said, what was the last time you checked? When was the last time you checked your BP? 1 year ago when I went to the same doctor for the checkup, annual checkup. So then I said, okay, so how do you know that it hasn't increased slowly over the whole year? No, but suddenly she was not able to understand this at all. How it suddenly increased? Please tell me yesterday it wasn't there, today it is there. So this is, you know, so one is always blindsided with this Dehatma Buddhi, and the feeling is Dehe Pushte Aham Pushtaha. If the body is nice, I am good. If the Dehe Nashte, Aham Nashta. If the body is destroyed, I am destroyed. And so one goes to great lengths to take care of the body. And I'm not saying, one should be, not taking care of the body. Take care of the body, because body, if you don't take care of it, who will take care of it? But we are talking of, you know, so many things. People just have this so many, daily routine. And then, you know, it's carried out to an extreme, great extent and great extreme. First I'll do this, then I'll do that, you know, then I have to go for a run. Oh, wait a minute, the latest study is that you can drop dead if you're running. So, okay, I should walk fast, I shouldn't run. Because walking, they say, is the best exercise. Then 5 years later, it will say, well, walking is, it's not even that great. And then what are we going to do? And then you should do yoga, okay, but not too much yoga, because then the tendons and everything will just get weak and whatnot. Shouldn't overuse this. And then you should swim, but then you shouldn't be, but the pools are all full of all kinds of bacteria. It will take you straight to the hospital. So better not swim. And then you should take antioxidants, but not too many, because then that will create some other kinds of things. So like this, there is, you know, for every notion connected with the body, a notion that this body is not okay, or the this part of the body is not okay, for every notion connected with the body, there is a lotion and a potion to calm down the notions connected with the body. And if all else fails, head to Florida. Why Florida?
Plastic surgery.
Yeah. All the, you know, they don't call, you should not call them plastic surgeons. It's very, apparently it's very offensive. Cosmetic surgeons, yeah. Because plastic means, you know, as though it's a false profession.
They're recycling.
Yeah. So, you know, they're pruning, cutting, nipping, whatever you don't like. And then, you know, this is very alarming. There's an alarming trend of body hating among young adults. Why? Because they're not, you know, nowadays nobody is looking at themselves even in a mirror. They're looking at themselves only in the cell phone camera. And then, you know, apparently there is something called a selfie face. And I don't know what it looks like. Yeah, it has... Yeah, and then the eyebrows should be high, and the cheekbones should be on the forehead somewhere. Selfie face. So as soon as the camera is out, and they take a million photos per day, you know, and as soon as the camera is out, everybody gets into that face. Why? Don't ask me. They think they look beautiful like that. Actually, just between you and me, you know, they all look horrid like that. Because it's a God-given face, and this stupid selfie face is overlaid on the God, you know, God, and the God-given face is effaced, you know, and then what? And then they're taking their, and then they look at that selfie. And then they say, oh, I wish I looked like that. I don't look like that. So they take the selfie to the cosmetic surgeons. I read one interview and they all say, and some of them are as young as 13. Yeah. You know. And so they go and they say that I would like to look just like this. The cheekbones should be pushing up the eyelids, and then, you know, the lips should be just half an inch wide, and then the face should be concave like this. And thankfully, the doctors that were interviewed, they have sent all of them back. They said, no, you're not. Even if the parents say, okay, go ahead and do it, because it's usually girls, young girls. She really wants it, go ahead and do it for her birthday. Please go to somebody else. I'm not doing this because this is not needed. So like this, you know, this is the body. Body is I. I'm as good as the body, and this selfie face should be my face. And so these kinds of things are very, very, you know, dangerous, because this is the mudha buddhi, dehatma buddhi. And so everything is carried to an extreme. And then the last decade, you know, in the 2000, up till 2000, the year 2000, people were popping vitamin E like candy. Oh, it's very good for the heart, very good for the heart. Now it says, if you take vitamin E more than what is needed, one will drop dead. Stop taking vitamin E. Who to believe? And the science will keep on conducting more and more research and hypothesis, and then, you know, debunking what was there. And so therefore, you know, this dehatma buddhi to overcome, a moderation is very much needed. You cannot just go on an extreme. And so therefore, the other thing to remember about dehatma buddhi is that, you know, karma comes to the body because the body is what, you know, is programmed to have karma. Karma comes to the body but does not touch you. But if dehatma buddhi is there, you start thinking that whatever is happening to the body is happening to me. And the I is affected. The I is never affected. And that is another reason to take care of dehatma buddhi as soon as it arises. And then, so here it says that, you know, outside also, when you start talking of bone, connective tissue, flesh, bone marrow, blood, arteries, you know, skin, fat, all this assemblage, already you have a little bit of a disgust for the body, okay? Mm-hmm. And then the last line, vin mutra shleshma purna, meaning it is full of excrement and urine and phlegm. That clinches it, you know. Sva para vapuhu. So your one's own body, sva vapuhu, your own body is like that, and the other, you know, and so this is so that one does not fall in love with another body. Paravapuhu, another body is equally an assemblage of all kinds of, and a disgusting amalgam of all kinds of things. And then samviditva api, samviditva means even though it is, they know this full well, and api bhuyaha means again and again, people make the same error, mistake. Mistake is made repeatedly, even though one knows that this is just a flesh, assemblage of flesh, blood, etc. Because, you know, when, you know, you go to some funeral and you view the dead body and you know that, okay, this is just an assemblage of flesh, bones and all, because the person indwelling it has gone. Where, you don't know, but they have departed. And then what? Then we have, you know, also the, you know, one knows that it is just filled with waste, etc. And toxins, waste, all these things. And then if your body is like that, other bodies are also like that. Knowing full well, what happens? They still fall under this dehatma buddhi. And so the first one is this, the, you know, verse number 4. Is very beautiful because it functions on multiple levels. It talks about the I notion centered on the body mind sense complex, and it also talks about how the deluded buddhi, the deluded the one of deluded intellect, goes about thinking I'm as good as this body, which is an assemblage of flesh, blood, bones, etc., and waste matter, and then whether it is one's own body or other people's body, still knowing full well, one still bhajati sevate. One does not stop this body identification. Aho, aho, you know, doesn't say that, but we have to just add, you know, alas. It's a lamentable fact that this association or this identification of with the body does not go away, even though one knows full well that one is not this body. Still, there is an addictive identification, and that is what he is, you know, pointing out. And then what else is there? What else have we not seen here? Atma, Chitvit, Sukhatma. Yeah, we've seen the whole thing. Yeah. Next one. Dehastri Putra Mitra.
Dehastri Putra Mitra.
Anuchara.
Anuchara.
Hayavrisha.
Hayavrisha.
Hayavrishaha.
Hayavrishaha.
Tosha hetur mametham.
Tosha hetur mametham.
Dehastri putra mitra anuchara.
Dehastri putra mitra anuchara.
Hayavrishastosha hetur mametham. Sarve svayur nayanti prathitam.
Sarve svayur nayanti prathitam.
Alamami.
Alamami.
Mamsami mamsayeha. Sarve svayur nayanti prathitamalam.
Sarve svayur nayanti prathitamalam.
Ami mamsami mamsayeha.
Ami mamsami mamsayeha.
Ete jivanti yena.
Ete jivanti yena.
Vyavahriti patavaha.
Vyavahriti patavaha.
Vyavahriti patavaha.
Vyavahriti patavaha.
Yena saubhagya bhajaha.
Yena saubhagya bhajaha.
Ete jivanti yena vyavahriti patavaha.
Ete jivanti yena vyavahriti patavaha.
Vyavahriti patavaha.
Vyavahriti patavaha.
Yena saubhagya bhajaha.
Yena saubhagya bhajaha.
Tam pranadhisham antargatam.
Tam pranadhisham antargatam.
Amritamamum.
Amritamamum.
Naiva mimamsayanti.
Naiva mimamsayanti.
Yeah, another, you know, complex verse. The first line is one word. The whole first line is one word. And so, like this, you know, complex construction, but very beautiful again. So now, the whole verse is talking about, in addition to the bodied as I delusion, that body as I delusion extends into property, people as I. And that is what is being talked about. And then here, there is a kind of a word play on the word mimamsa. Mimamsa means analysis. And the word is, you know, it's got a particular suffix called sun. You know, sun is the suffix, and then when that sun suffix comes, it's a particular way of arriving at the, taking the root verb and arriving at the the formulated verb. And so here the root verb is man. Man means pujayam, worship, and man also means to measure. So these two verbs together make mimamsa, and the sun, you know, suffix takes a duplication of the first word. So man, man, and then we are told that it should be me, ma, you know, me, the first of the duplicated becomes me, me, mamsa, worshipful analysis. And it is only used for the Veda. Veda, Vedanta is analyzed with Shraddha, worshipfully. It's a special word, very nicely derived, me, mamsa, you know. And then here, he's playing on the word me, mamsa. And in Sanskrit, the word mamsa means what? Flesh. So mamsa be mamsa. So what are these people doing? They are doing, they're indulging in the philosophy of the flesh rather than the philosophy of I, Atma. So that is the word play here. So I'm, you know, talking about that first so you can enjoy that. So let us see the meaning. Deha, body. Okay. Three, woman, and then you can put man also, you know, because it's a man writing in those days and for other men, that is why it is like that. But deha, stree. Stree means any kind of a, you know, object, a person who attracts, you know, so it can be man, woman, whatever. And then, so deha, instead of stree, you can put spouse, and then you can say putra, child. Mitra, friend. Anujara, anujara means employee. Haya, haya means horse. Vrishaha, vrishaha means what? Cattle. Yeah. What did you think? No, vrikshaha. No. Vriksha. That's different. There is ksha there. Here there is vrishaha. Like Vrishabha means bull. So Vrishabha means all kinds of cattle, buffaloes, you know, and cows, buffaloes, all in that, you know, in that category. You know, Vrishabha. Tosha Hetuhu means these things in this list. What are they? Body, spouse, child, friend, employee, horses, cattle. You know, instead of horses, cattle, you can say your car and then other possessions, you know. Yeah, house, etc. Tosha hetuhu means they are the cause of happiness. Tosha, contentment. They are the cause of my contentment. So mama tosha hetuhu ittham. This much alone is the cause of my contentment. This much alone means whatever is there in the list. These are the things that make me delighted, contented, and these are the cause of my contentment. Who thinks like that? Sarve, everyone, you know. Again, you know, a nice reprieve, because I'm not the only one. For everyone, this is a normal way of going about life, you know. What do you want in life? I want a nice home. I want nice set of wheels. And then that is, you know, cattle and whatever. I want, but cattle is money. So I want money. Livelihood. So I want money. I want a nice set of wheels. And then I want a house. I want a loving family. You know, children. And then I want a few people to boss over. So I should have some employees. Yeah, somebody who will listen to me. And to that you can add dog, cat, donkey, whatever else, you know, one loves to have. Okay? So all this is there. And this much alone one sees, you know, is the cause of one's happiness. Tosha hetuhu. So if any of these things in the list disappoint, then what happens? You know, shoka hetu, the dosha hetu becomes shoka hetu. Shoka hetu means the cause of sorrow. So that's why, you know, there in every marriage there is such a thing called honeymoon period. Yeah. So that is when the person, the other person, the significant other, is dosha hetu, source of great contentment. And then after that, what happens? Becomes shoka hetu, becomes a cause of sorrow. That's why then you say the honeymoon has ended. Yeah. Why? Because you've lived with the person for a few weeks or months, and then after that, you suddenly find that you cannot live with them at all. You know? And so, why can't you live with them? Because it is completely different. You want the window open, they want to everything closed. You want to go out, they want to stay in, you know, with the closed windows. And then, and then what, you know, you like something and that happens to be the thing they hate. And then what? Then there are children in the picture. And as though, you know, with great difficulty you are somehow bridging the gap between you and this person that you are living with, you know, who is soon becoming shoka hetu. And then the children become teenagers in that time. They also become shoka hetu, you know. Because when they were small, they were delightful, how cute, how sweet. And then what? Then you have to watch them all the time. And then that is also, you know, it's nerve-wracking, anxiety-producing. And so all this is, you know, the dosha hetu doesn't take time to quickly turn. Faster than milk can curdle, dosha hetu becomes shoka hetu. And same thing with dogs and cats. People say, you know, people really plan and they have fights in the family. Which dog, which breed, which cat, and how it should be. Where will we go to get it? And then they finally go and get it. And then they find that, you know, they wanted something. Whatever they want, they will never get. This is karma, okay? And so they'll find, they wanted something that is a family type dog, well adjusted, laid back, low. And instead they got this, and you know, anxiety machine, you know, which is always frightened, you know, always jumping. And this is what, I mean, this is actually, somebody told me this. You know, they wanted one mellow dog and they got a hyper dog. And they wanted another, you know, one will say, I wanted a calm dog, and instead got a dog that bites everyone, you know, without saying anything, it will just quietly go bite and come. And shoka hetu. Yeah. And all, okay, even if you get a mellow dog, just like you, the one you wanted, then what happens after some time? After some time, you know, it grows old. Then you have to take it to the vet, you know, pet to the vet. And then after that, what? And then it you know, now there is organic food also for the pets. You can barely afford to eat from the regular shop, okay? But for the pet, you will go to the organic food because the vet said so. And then you will get organic food for the dog. And then dog, you know, dog seva. And then what else, you know? And then still, you know, it is short-lived, 14, 15 years max. And so then, after it goes also, shoka hetu. And then, what, you know, it's very painful. Because one is, you know, it's become a family member by now. And so, this is what it is. So, dosha hetu, that which you think is the cause of happiness, and you feel like you have it down. If I have this items on the list, oh Lord, I'm not going to bother you at all. I'm the happiest person. Because this is what is the cause of my happiness. And then Bhagavan comes and says, Tathastu, may you have this. And then what? Ayo, I want to, you know, I didn't want this. I didn't want that. I wanted this, but not like this. You know, well, this is how it is. Because there is a hidden, you can control the known variables. But you cannot control the unknown variables, you know, hidden variables. That hidden variable is Bhagavan in the form of karma. So that's why such a person will get such a life partner and such a child and such a pet. All these things are there, you know. And so this is what is being told here. mama ittham, so this much is for me. And then who thinks like that? Thankfully, sarve, everyone. Swayuhu nayanti. Swayuhu is a very nice word, swayus, which means the vitality and vigor and passion in life, the creative, you know, juice, along with the ojas, the tejas, all these things. Swayuhu nayanti. Nayanti means they lead their lives, prathitam, spreading out in this particular way. Spreading out means, you know, declaring, you know, that this is what they want, this is how everyone leads their life. And then he says, alam, enough of this now, wake up. Ami means this, you know, alam ami, enough of this. Alam ami, and what is this? Mamsa mimamsaya alam. Enough of this philosophy of the flesh. Mamsa mimamsa, it's almost like you're doing mimamsa. On the mamsa, you're doing research on all kinds of various bodies, and you're saying these are bodies of that I like, and this kind of a body of a cat, cow, dog, and what else, cattle, horses, whatever it is. So these are the bodies I like, children, employee, wife, husband, all these things. And then, so enough of this mamsa mi, alam mamsa mimamsa ya. Because this alam, always the word alam takes the next word, enough of what? That of what takes the third case. So mimamsaya, like lataya, iha, enough of this now here. And then, you know, so this is a little wake up call, and he says that you are doing mimamsa over something, all finite things, you are doing analysis, worshipful analysis is reserved for the finite. Whereas the infinite Lord is totally forgotten by you, he will say in the last line. We'll see that later. When is the next class? I don't know. Again, travel is coming. September 11th, I'm giving a talk from 6:30 to 8 p.m. And I will try to put it on Adobe. So you can take that. It is on Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. Just one talk. That's going to be somewhere in Mill Peters, San Jose, California.
6:30 our time.
6:30 our time, because California is in our time only. 6:30 to 8, you can log on Adobe. It will not be on live stream. Andrew will maybe put it up later. Okay?
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.
And this Saturday we have two classes on Bodhisara, 9 o'clock or 9:30. 9:30 to noon, 9:30 a.m. to noon, and 9:30 to 10:30 first class. Then we take a 15-minute break and then another class. And this is on Bodhisara this particular Saturday, which is the 7th of September. Okay, all the best.
So there is
Saturday.
Thursday and Friday.
Oh,
what happened to those? Yeah.